His wonderful love. I saw Jesus when I prayed last night. Listen to this verse. Yes, my dear mother told me a long time ago, trust in Jesus, He will make your future bright. Now I understand the meaning of His wonderful love. I saw Jesus, yes, Lord, when I prayed last night. When I prayed last night, I heard my Savior say, come to me and I will make your burdens light. Then we walked through the garden and we stood by His grave. I saw Jesus when I prayed last night. Hallelujah. I'm going to do one more song. How many know we're going up yonder to see our Lord? Amen. I have the assurance that I have a mother and a father and loved ones over there, but I want to see Jesus. How about you? Because of Him that we get to go to that place called heaven. Oh, yes. This is a stand-up song. Clap your hands for the Lord. If you want to know where I'm going, I'm going soon. Anybody ask you where I'm going, I'm going soon. I'm going up yonder. I'm going up yonder to be with my Lord. Oh, I'm going up yonder. I'm going up yonder. Going up yonder to be with my Lord. Jesus took the pain, the heartache that it brings. There is joy in knowing I'm gonna soon be gone. God gives me grace, I'm gonna run this race till I see my Savior face to face. Oh, I'm going up yonder. Yes, Lord. I'm going up yonder. I'm going up yonder to be with my Lord. Oh, I'm going up yonder. Are you going? I'm going up yonder. Going up yonder to be with my Lord. Hallelujah. Somebody clap your hands and say, thank you, Jesus. Look at your neighbors. I plan on being there. Yeah. As God gives me grace, I'm going to run this race. till I see my Savior face to face. Oh, I'm going up yonder. I'm going up yonder. Going up yonder to be with my Lord. Oh, I'm going up yonder. I'm going up yonder. I'm going up yonder to be with my Lord. Oh, I'm going up yonder. I'm going up yonder. Going up yonder to be with my Lord. Oh, I'm going up yonder. I'm going up yonder. I'm going up yonder to be with my Lord. Woo! My. That makes you feel good all over, better than any place else. To know that we got a place to go to when this life is over. You know, people get excited about ball games and NASCAR and catching big fish and politics. Not too much to shout about there. But anyway, we're going to see Jesus. I said, we're going to see Jesus, the man that died for us, that hung between the heavens and the earth and gave his life's blood for you and I. That whosoever shall call upon his name shall be saved. Anybody saved here today, shout amen. If you're saved and you know it, shout amen. If you're saved, not ashamed of it, put your hand up and say amen. Woo! Glory to God, glory to God. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Paul said, I will therefore that men pray everywhere. Somebody say everywhere. I will therefore that men pray everywhere. Somebody say everywhere. Lifting up holy hands. Lifting up holy hands. Lifting up holy hands. Lifting up holy hands without wrath and without doubting. Honey, when you lift your hands up to the Lord, you know what you're saying. I surrender, Lord. I'm surrendering everything. I'm lifting up my hands. I surrender everything to you, Jesus. Jesus took the pain and the heartaches that life brings. Listen. But there's a joy in knowing we're going to soon be gone. Oh, I'm going up yonder. I'm going up yonder. I'm going up yonder to be with my Lord. Oh, I'm going up yonder. I'm going up yonder. I'm going up yonder to be with my Lord. Oh, I'm going up yonder. Going up yonder, going up yonder to be with my Lord. Ooh. I'll tell you what, I don't know about you, but I feel something in this place. And it's the Spirit of the Lord. Let's sing this old, I feel Jesus. I feel Jesus. I feel Jesus in this place. And my heart does burn within me, I feel Jesus in this place. I just feel like healing's around here right now. I feel healing. I feel healing. I feel healing. I feel healing in this place. And my soul, oh yes it does. And my soul does burn within me. I feel Jesus in this place. Can you say amen? Glory to God. You can be seated if you can. Praise the Lord. If you have a Bible today, I want you to open that Bible to Luke's Gospel. Luke's Gospel, the 22nd chapter. While you're doing that, give our musicians a God bless you. Such an anointed music. Sometimes they make me sound better than what I really am. Amen. By the way, on March the 18th, that's a Saturday night, we're going to have Saturday Night Live right here at Victory Temple on Broadway, by the way. I told him, I said, and he's deceased now, Dave Wilkerson in heaven, but I said, he's not the only one who has a revival on Broadway. Amen. We have a revival on Broadway. 6 p.m. on March the 18th. My son Richard, he's on our latest project singing several songs. Everybody likes Beulah Land and the Blood. That's some of his signature songs. And he'll be singing, and I'll be singing. Bishop Drennan will be singing and playing that organ as only he can. Amen. I recommend any churches around here got an organ, got dust in it. I recommend Bishop Drennan. He can blow the dust out of that thing. Amen. Hallelujah. And then the next day on March the 19th, Brother James and Janice, or Joyce Jones, I should say, in Revelations, a singing group. And Brother James played at one time with Gene Martin years ago. They're old acquaintances of ours. And they have a singing group. And they're going to be here on that Sunday morning, March the 19th. So you can make your plans to be here for that. Let me back up just a little bit. The last Sunday in this month is going to be Black History Sunday. Amen. Every year for several years, probably over 20 years, we celebrated Black History Month. And we've had guest speakers in the past that preached on black evangelists and so forth. But for the last few years, Sister Wanda King has been doing a superb job teaching us on black history. And she and her family were the first black people that came to our church, that came to us. We started in 74, about 1975. They came, their entire family came, and they're still with us today. Wanted to know if black folks had come, and now we can't get rid of them. Hey, not that we want to. Amen. But anyway, the last Sunday in this month, we will be celebrating Black History Month. And it's going to be a high time in the Lord. And while I'm doing this, on May the 28th through June the 4th will be our 43rd anniversary, celebrating over 40 years of miracles, signs, and wonders. And May the 28th through June the 4th, on May the 2nd, I should say June the 2nd, Friday night, June the 2nd, we will have the Miracle Eye service. And Prophetess Teresa Davis will be preaching that week. And Pastor Marissa Davis will be having a Thursday and a Friday noon service, high noon, 12 noon. So If you don't come to church, it won't be my fault. Amen. For those that work night shift, you can come to the noon service. Amen. Because we aim to please around here. Praise the Lord. In Luke's Gospel, the 22nd chapter, before I get started, I want to read this praise report. Got this week. There's a lady called Deborah that called, and her husband, she had ordered the blood of Jesus oil, and her husband, she prayed for her husband, had lower back pain, and he said he had the best day at work yesterday and feels better than he has in 20 years. 20 years. Hallelujah. Lord, isn't that a blessing? All she did was just follow the instructions and anointed him with the blood of Jesus oil. And I reiterate, I've said it several thousand times. I know there's no virtue or no healing in this oil. It's an act of faith, according to James 5:14. If you're sick, call for the elders of the church. And when people call Prophet Woody Martin, they're calling an elder. I've been preaching over 50 years. I guess that makes me an elder. Amen. Amen. So that's calling. And I send them the oil. They follow the instructions. And God gave her husband, healed his back, pain-free after 20 years. If you never had back trouble, you don't know the magnitude of this miracle. Amen. So thank God for Deborah letting us know that her husband was healed by using the anointing oil. All right, St. Luke's Gospel, the 22nd chapter, and we're going to start at verse 31. St. Luke's Gospel, 22nd chapter, beginning at verse 31. Hallelujah. And it reads thus, "And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat." I want you to get that. Jesus is talking to one of his hand-picked disciples, Peter, Simon Peter. And he says, Satan has desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. But, I'm going to say right up front, if you're worth your salt in God, Satan desires to have you too. But, Scripture declares, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivered them out of them. So Jesus says, Satan, Simon, Peter, Satan has desired to have you that he might sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you. I have prayed for you that your faith fails not. Mm-mm-mm. I have prayed for you that your faith faileth not. Let's read it again. I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not, and when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. Now, Satan's desire to have Peter was much like Job in the Old Testament. Because the devil accused God of blessing Job with everything. No wonder he serves you. You've got all these material blessings. No wonder he serves you. And this is the reason that the enemy, Satan, came up against Peter. Because he was tried in that same area. Satan always tests our faith. I said Satan. I said Satan will test your faith. Why? Because it's an attack on your future. An attack on your faith is an attack on your future. Because without faith, it is impossible to please God. So if the enemy attacks your faith today, he's wanting to destroy your future because he knows without faith you cannot please God. So an attack on your faith is an attack on your future. Everybody say this way, say it this way. An attack on my faith is an attack on my future. Now why is Jesus warning Peter? Because he knows Peter is going to be used. In fact, that he prophesied to Peter, and Satan heard that prophecy as well. Somebody say, an attack on my faith is an attack on my future. Now, why did Satan attack Peter's faith? Because Jesus had prophesied to Peter about his future. Hello? Hello? Hold your place. Let's go right quickly. Hold your place right there. We'll come back. Let's go to Matthew, the 16th chapter. Matthew, the 16th chapter. Let's go there right quickly. Just hold your place. Matthew, the 16th chapter and verse 13. I don't hear no pages turning. I heard one then. Amen. Hallelujah. Matthew, the 16th chapter. When Jesus came to the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples a question. He took his own personal survey. Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Some say you're John the Baptist. Some say you're Elijah. Some say you're one of the prophets. But he says, who do you say that I am? And Peter replied and said, verse 16, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God, not the dead God, but the living God. You're Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said unto him, verse 17, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood have not revealed this unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. That's a prophecy that he gave to Peter. Well, I'm here to tell you today that the gates of hell cannot prevail about the true church of Christ that Jesus purchased with his own blood. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say unto you that thou art Peter, and upon this rock. The church is not built on Peter. It's part of it. The Bible says that the church is built upon the apostles, the prophets, Jesus Christ being the chief cornerstone. But all of us working together make a corporation of the church or the body of Christ. I'm not the church, but I'm part of it. You're not the church, but you're part of it. So you're in the church. You're in the body of Christ. And Satan hears that word when Jesus said, upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Somebody told me one time, said, do you know that church over there split down the middle? I said, it must have been worse than hell. Because Jesus said the gates of hell would prevail against his church. I'm preaching better than you're letting on right now. Amen. Look at verse 19. I will give thee the keys of the kingdom, and what thou shalt bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Hallelujah. Whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Now watch this, watch this, watch this. Verse 20. From that time forth began Jesus to show his disciples how they must go into Jerusalem and suffer many things for the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed and raised again the third day. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him. Peter began to rebuke Jesus. I don't think anybody's going to rebuke Jesus and get by with it. Hello? Peter rebuked him, saying, this is not true. Be it far from thee, Lord. This shall not be unto thee. And he turned and said to Peter, get thee behind me. What did he call him? He just got through telling him he gave him the keys to the kingdom. Next verse, he's calling him Satan. Get behind me, Satan, because you don't speak the things that be of God, but you speak the things that be of man. Because Jesus' destiny was to go to the cross and die for the world. That was his calling. He said, I didn't come to do my will, but I came to do the will of him that sent me. Verse 22, he turned to Peter and said, get behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou sayest not the things that be of God, but those that be of man. And I reiterate, when Jesus told Peter and prophesied to him that he, Peter, would have the keys to the kingdom, Satan heard that. When you receive a prophecy in this church, and many times your prophecies are conditional, and your prophecies sometimes take a long time. It's a seasonal thing. Amen. It's a seasonal thing. How many of you ever went through a season, a certain song for 6 months? It just ministered to you. You want to hear it every day, every day, every day. Well, that season was over. And then you got another song that ministered to you, or another word that ministered to you. It's seasonal. But I want you to know it's God's season for you here this morning. Your season has come. Your due season is here today. Somebody shout today. Say, my season is here now. So Jesus, let's go back to Luke 22. Let's go back to Luke 22. So as I said, Satan tests our faith. It's an attack on our future. And he sees, just like he did Job, he tries to throw everything in your pathway to get you discouraged, to get you out of the will of God. So therefore, he tries to do that to hinder your faith for the future. Amen? So the reason that Satan came up against Peter, because he had the keys to the kingdom. Look at verse 32. Luke 22:32. I pray for thee that your faith fail not. Amen. Now why did he say, I pray that your faith fail not? Because when your faith fails, everything fails. Your faith is your prized possession through the Lord Jesus Christ. So when your faith fails, everything fails, because without faith you cannot. And that's the key that Satan is trying to do, is to steal your faith. And by doing so, he's going to steal your tomorrows, your future. Now let's watch this very closely. Let me read it again. And verse 32, I pray for thee that thy faith fail not. Everybody say this, faith does not make things easy. Say it again, faith does not make things easy. Faith makes things possible. Faith don't make things easy. Faith makes things possible through the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the reason the enemy tries to steal your faith. Because he can steal your future if he'll get you discouraged. Now you can't get that miracle. Now so-and-so might, but you don't have enough faith to get your miracle. Well, tell him he's a liar. God's given me a measure of faith. He's given you a measure of faith. Everybody saved has a measure of faith. It's up to you to use your measure of faith. It's sort of like a bodybuilder. If you don't exercise and get your muscle tone on the bike or the trainer or whatever, you're going to look like some of these men weigh 400 pounds. They won't be in good shape like I am. Hey, I haven't had any sugar in my body since January the 10th. Nothing but natural. Oranges, apples, almonds. Well, almonds. You know, you can eat 6 almonds and your taste buds die. Of course, you don't want them to die, do you? You want to feed them. Don't drink no soft drinks, only water. And I will admit I'm a coffee man. I like my coffee. But water's in coffee. No sweets. No search. No chewing gum. No cough drops. No mints. And I know I need them sometime. No pies. No cakes. No cookies. No candy. No sugar in my body. I've lost over 10 pounds already. Amen. If I want to live to be 120, I'm 76. I got to take care of my body. And you shouldn't put man-made stuff in your body. If God grows it, it's got to be good. Amen. I love vegetables. Well, let's not go on that. I'm not preaching about diet. But, you know, people are obese, and I'm not making fun of them. And they abuse their bodies different ways. And then come up and ask God to heal them after you've poisoned your body with things that you put in your body. God will teach you how to eat right. How many times, you don't have to say amen, but how many times when you was eating and you said to yourself, that's enough. But you just pushed on a little bit further. I said you didn't have to say amen, but you can say amen. All right, let's get back to this. When your faith fails, everything fails. Say that one more time. When your faith fails, everything fails. Faith does not make things easy. Faith makes things possible. And all things are possible to those that believe. Somebody shout, I'm a believer. Somebody shout, I'm a believer. Somebody say, I am a believer. All things are possible to Mickey Shelton if he believes. All things are possible to Lois Edmonds if she believes. All things are possible to the body of Christ if we believe. And God has dealt with every man the measure of faith. Gene Martin used to sing, we still sing it sometimes, faith, 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 just a little bit of faith. It don't take a whole lot, just use that little bit that you got. And the enemy is attacking that little bit of faith that you have. Oh, help me, Jesus. Now, let's continue reading. He said in him, verse 33. No, let me back up. Verse 32. Can I take my time? I'm trying to beat those Baptist Shoneys. That ain't going to work. Amen. I'm just kidding. It's really a Cracker Barrel. All right. But let's look at verse 32. I'm going to help you here. But I have prayed for thee. Jesus said, Peter, I pray for you that your faith fail not. I pray for you that your faith fail not. And when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. Now, this doesn't mean that he's got to get saved again. He's already saved. He's already a hand-picked disciple. He said, I pray for you that your faith fail not. Because when your faith fails, everything fails, folks. The entire Christian life is based upon faith through the Lord Jesus Christ. And when he says, when you're strengthened, the brother, when you're converted, strengthened a brother does not mean being saved again, but staying on the right path and depending on the Lord and not depending on yourself. How many times we get so confident in ourselves, we think that we can do this, we can do this thing. No, without the Lord. Jesus even told his disciples, without me, you can do nothing. So when he says, in his precious word, when you're converted, strengthen the brother. stay on the right path and depend on the Lord, then you're able to strengthen the brother. How can I strengthen you if I'm not converted to the right path? The Lord Jesus Christ. How can I strengthen people on television if I could? You never hear me come in here on Sunday morning with a defeated message. I always have a pot. Now, I'll preach against sin. Amen. I'll preach against sin, sure enough. But when I come in here, I try to build your faith because I know you're fighting demon spirits from another world. And God says, I give you power over all the powers of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. But Margaret, fine, how can I help you if I am defeated myself? How can I help Merle Crudup when he was dying? And I say to myself, oh, I'm going to pray for him, but he's going to die. Don't pray. If you got that type of faith, don't lay your hands on me. You know what Merle and his wife and his family and I had to do? We had to take authority over death. We had to postpone death. And if I didn't have enough faith to postpone death, I'd have been dead myself. Satan attacks our faith in order to defeat us in the future. I went in there and prayed for Merle. I had a lady in Fort Lauderdale. I think it's her son or grandson. And he was in the hospital, and they just said he was going to die. There's nothing they could do. In fact, about one time they lost him and he came back to life. And that crazy woman heard me preach on this anointing oil. I mean, that smart woman. It takes a smart person to believe God. And I'll think about it in a minute. The lady that anointed her mother, she went that night to the hospital that called the family members in. Kidneys burn up from dialysis. 3 times a week on dialysis. Kidneys just burn up. Her mother's 80-something years old. And she goes in there. I told her, I said, go and anoint your mother with oil for the next 7 days and God will heal her. And they said she's going to die. Don't you know it took faith for me to say that? But she went that night. I gave her the oil that night. She went to the hospital that night and anointed her mother. She went the next day and anointed her mother. On the 6th day, she anointed her again. And on the 7th day after she anointed her mother, they released her. Sent her home, and all the family members that came in from Baltimore and New York, instead of having a funeral and having a wake, they had a cookout in the backyard. Had a celebration, had a barbecue in the backyard. Satan attacks your faith in order to defeat you in the future. Amen. So stay on the right. When you're strengthened, when you're converted, strengthen your brother or sister. How can you strengthen them if you're worse off than they are? How can I encourage you if I preach defeated messages all the time? Hallelujah. I get calls and texts every week. People wanting to come and hear me preach. Come to our church for a revival. And when I see a crowd like this, I think sometimes I should be there. Amen. Truth demands an audience. Hallelujah. So, stay on the right path and depend on the Lord, and then you can strengthen the brethren. You know why they called on me at my class reunion, this past class reunion? To pray for my schoolmates. They know my reputation. One of them said, we never thought Woody'd turn out to be a rabbi. But But I took my anointed oil. I started praying for people there at my reunion. And we're getting reports that some of them been healed. Now, I couldn't have done that if I didn't have faith. Peter went to the beautiful gate and told the man, said, I ain't got no money, but I've got something else such that I have. I give it to you in the name of Jesus. Rise up and walk. He gave him something because he had something. Glory to God. Somebody say, God is good. All right. 33. And he said unto him, Peter said, Lord, I'm ready to go with thee both to prison and to death. You remember what he told him earlier? This shall not be so. You'll not have to go and die. I'll go with you. I'll fight for you. Get behind me, Satan. You don't see the things that are of God. That's another thing. If you get a prophecy from the Lord, it will correspond with God's word. It will not contradict the word of God. I mean, bishops on television make me sick. God told me to divorce my wife and marry a younger woman. No, he didn't. You took her for better or worse. Some of them, one woman can't satisfy them sexually. Got perverted spirits. I told you I'll preach the truth now. Don't look at me that way. I better get off of that. But Peter said, I'll go with you. And Jesus said, you'll deny me three times. Look at it. Verse 34. He said, Peter, the cock shall not crow this day, but before that thou shalt thrice deny that thou knowest me. And three times Peter denied knowing the Lord. He was warming by the devil's fire. And this young lady said, didn't you come up here, that man from Galilee, that Jesus man? I don't know him. I don't know him. Warming by the devil's fire and denying the Lord Jesus Christ. See, that prophecy came to pass as well. Now follow me. Verse 35. Jesus says, when I sent you out with purse, the purse that they had, like a woman's purse, had a strap over their shoulder, about waist length, and they would carry their belongings in there. And Jesus said, when I sent you without purse, the first time he sent them out, said, don't take no purse with you. Don't take no money with you. And don't take no American Express credit cards with you. And don't take no scrip. Anybody know what scrip is? But don't take no purse. Don't take no scrip. And the latter part, he said, don't even take no shoes. What? He's sending them out two by two to preach. Now some of you look at me like that's not in there. Let's see if it is. He said to them, verse 35, when I sent you without purse and scrip and shoes, he sent them out, they didn't even have no shoes. He sent them out barefooted, if you please. He said, lacked you anything? Did you lack anything when I sent you out of the purse? Did you lack anything when I sent you without scrip and money? Did you lack anything when I sent you without shoes? They said, nothing, Lord. In other words, I will supply all your need according to my riches and glory. God's still God. He can still rain manna down from heaven. The angels are not on food stamps, passing out food stamps. Not opposed to that. Amen. He give us this day our daily, 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 daily bread. Now, after that, they said nothing. We didn't have no purse, didn't have no scrip, didn't have no shoes. We didn't lack anything. And they said, we didn't lack nothing, Lord. Now, he said unto them, but now. Everybody say, but now. This time it's going to be different. I'm changing it. But now, he that hath a purse, let him take it. Meaning, you're going to get some money to go in that purse. Well, I lost you there. He that have a purse, if you got a purse, you take that purse. And likewise, if you got any scrip, you got any money, take that with you. And if you do not have a sword, sell a garment and buy a sword. Our founding fathers got it right to have a gun for protection. And Jesus said, if you don't have a sword, you're going to need a sword. So you take a garment or do a barter trade or something and get you a sword. Because the enemy is going to try to come up against you and kill you. I believe in guns. You don't believe in guns, you try to get in my house at night and you'll find out. Amen. That gun's not to protect me, it's to protect you from me killing you. Hello? Everybody say, Jesus told him to get a sword. What's the favorite weapon of ISIS? You got it. What are they like? They like to cut the Christians' heads off. They use a what? And Jesus told his disciples, if you got a purse, take it with you. If you got scrip, take it with you. And if you don't have a sword, trade a garment, trade something, and get you a sword. You remember when Peter cut the servants of the high priest's ear off? I mean, he took a sword and sliced it off. And it fell to the ground. And Jesus went down there and picked it up and blew the dust off of it, stuck it back on there. Now the Bible, King James didn't say blow the dust off. That's Woody Martin. I remember Peggy was going, I made myself a sandwich, and we had one last bread and butter pickle in the jar. And I reached in there and got that bad boy, and it's like a fish. It slipped out of my hand, fell on the floor. And I knew she wasn't there, and I picked it up and ate it. Because somebody told me Peggy Martin's floor is clean enough to eat off of. That's a compliment, Miss Martin. Take it. And Jesus said, take a purse, if you got it. If you got scrip or money, take that with you. If you don't have a sword, you get you a sword. God expects a man to protect his family. The man is supposed to be the priest over his house and take care of his family, his wife and children. Well, you know I'm right about it. Let me read that one more time and I'm going to be through. He said unto them, verse 36, but now, everybody say, but now. I'm changing a little bit, but now he that hath a purse, let him take it, and likewise his scrip, and he that hath no sword, let him sell a garment and buy a sword. Somebody say, that's good preaching. I believe it is too. I'm through. Somebody say, thank you, Lord. Some of you are sick today. Some of you have health issues. Some have family issues. Some have job issues. All type of issues. Some of your children have issues at school. If it's not with a teacher, it's a bully. Everybody has some type of problem. I get requests through the mail, and Teresa helps me read the mail, and Peggy. And sometimes people say, pray that I have no more problems. Well, you have to get to heaven before that happens. You're not going to live this life with no problems. But I'm going to pray for you today. And if you need the Lord, you need God to move in your life. You need a healing. This is the 5th of February. On January the 1st, right here in this church, Ginger Morgan received sight and an eye that was blind. And I got witnesses right now. God healed her. 5 years ago, they gave Merle Crudup up to die. 24 hours to live. 24 hours to live. Call in the family members. Margaret Fine was there. Wanda was there. And Teresa was there. And Gina and Harry came by. And they're all standing around waiting for him to die. Because that's what the doctor said. But Isaiah 53 says, who hath believed our report? The report of the Lord says, he was wounded for my transgression, bruised for my iniquity. The chastisement of my peace was upon Jesus, and with his stripes, with his stripes. Somebody finish it. With his stripes. See, the devil will try to steal your faith, Debbie, because he knows you're going to have to use that faith tomorrow. Amen. I really don't, but I'm going to say, there is not a prayer that you can pray and pray that prayer and then never have no more problems. Amen. Invariably, if you get the victory of one thing, the devil will throw something else in your path. Amen. And you know what? It keeps you praying. Amen. It keeps you humble. Yes, my Lord. Amen. I want to pray for you right now. If you need prayer, I want this lady from Morristown to come up here. I spoke to her briefly as I came in. If you need prayer, if you're not saved and you want to be saved, I want you to come as well. Hallelujah. Because we're going to pray the prayer of faith. The prayer of faith shall save the sick. And the Lord will raise them up. Come on up here. Come on up here. Come on. Hallelujah. Come on. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Everybody come on up here. I'm glad you brought your neighbor today. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Now everybody turn around and face me. Just back up just a little bit. Yes, 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 yes. Hallelujah. 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 Glory to God. Give me just a little bit. The Lord told me to give this to you. I know you gave it to me earlier, but here's the instruction. I've anointed with oil. And God said to sleep with this for the next 7 nights. Mother Lewis, she's in heaven. To be 84 years old, and she would sleep with a New Testament in her gown, her pajamas. And during the night, she'd wake up, some of her bones, her knee, her elbow would start aching, and she'd take that little testament and rub her body. And she said, "The Lord says His word is health to all my flesh." God said, "Take that." Glory to God. Lay my hand upon you. I drive out every evil spirit that's come up against you in the name of Jesus. Oh God, give me a right now miracle. Touch him, Lord, in his body. Heal him, Lord, for your glory in Jesus' name. There it is. What'd you say?
I receive it.
Oh, I like that. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Go up there and get me one of those white handkerchiefs. On that tambourine. Yes, 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 yes. Ella Sue made these for me. And as God speaks to me, I anoint them and use them. This handkerchief says prayers from Brother Martin and the Victory Temple Church. God told me to lay it. I'm going to give that to you, but God told me to lay it on your head to get all the clutter out of your mind. You know what I'm talking about? I said, God told me to lay that on your head to get all the clutter out of your mind.
Right.
Amen. And when you get to where you stay, I want you to take this handkerchief and just touch the front door. After you open the front door, I want you to open the front door and put that handkerchief on that front door. I want you to say these words: devil, take your hell and get the hell out of my house.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Glory.
There's not going to be no rattling chains, no strange noises. Am I talking to you?
Glory. Oh,
no strange sounds, no strange noises. You're going to sleep good. You're not going to break that sleep after you go to sleep. God says you're going to sleep like a child. Oh, I break that witchcraft spirit in the name of Jesus. Glory to God. Somebody say thank you, Lord. Somebody say thank you, Jesus. You came to this church years ago, many times. Where do you live now?
I live in Englewood now. I live closer.
Live closer so you can come more. Right. Amen. Hallelujah. Can I anoint you with this oil?
I need two new kneecaps. They're giving away and deteriorating on me. And I can hardly walk, but I won't give in to it. I keep going, and God keeps giving me the strength.
Amen.
Some days I go with pain free. Some day it comes back, but I need two new kneecaps.
April, would you come here and put your hands on both kneecaps? Just kneel down there and touch her kneecaps. Hato, le, oh, God. In the name of Jesus. God, give her two new kneecaps. Lord, give her two new kneecaps, Lord. No surgery. Cancel surgery. In the name of Jesus. Do it right now, Lord. Oh!
Yes, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Now lift your leg up. Lift that leg up.
Tennessee
walking home.
Yes. Woo.
Oh, you're getting them lubricated now.
Yes. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus. I know you're like me. You got many miles on your body. But God says you're not about to run out of gas. He's not through with you yet.
I believe God has shown me I could be standing here when he comes back to earth.
Woo! I believe it. Yeah.
Woo!
See that woman over in that blue sweater? Go over and hug her, that blue sweater right there. Go over and tell her you hug her. Those knees were hurting before.
Yep.
Are they hurting now?
They're still just a little bit sore.
Just a little bit sore.
I ain't been healed, but since I come in here, I'm a...
God, you're getting Holy Ghost therapy.
Okay, thank you.
Ooh. Ooh, glory to God. Bless the Lord in Jesus' name. I decree that this will not return in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Are you all right?
I'm fine.
Huh? Now, what did I tell you to do with this hanky?
Touch the door. Touch my door. Tell the devil to leave.
Take his hell.
Leave my house. Don't
get the hell out of your house.
Get the hell out of my house.
Somebody say hell three times. That's in your Bible, by the way. Well, don't say hell. They hate me. No, I'm saying hell. And in hell, the rich man lift up his eyes being in torment. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus.
My knees feel sore and like they're wanting to hurt, and I've never felt that like this before. But the devil's trying.
That's the healing.
Healing. Woo! Thank God. Thank you, Jesus.
The pain is leaving.
Yes.
The pain has left.
Yes.
You got feeling come back into your knees because they feel like they're sore and they hadn't done that before. You better watch it. You go.
They feel sore. But they have been feeling that way. It's just like I need to go to the doctor and get something for them. But I'm feeling a different feeling today. I feel a soreness in there, But also, I can seem like I can move them better now. But they're still sore. The devil's trying to tell me, oh, they're still sore. So he's the liar.
Amen. Victory.
Amen.
Lord. Amen. You just keep on doing that Holy Ghost exercise. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, sweet Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I love you with the love of the Lord. Amen. This young lady's been faithful to our church for 10 years. Amen. Hallelujah. And she's still here. She's like Wanda King's family. She's been with us all these years, and I thank God for that. Amen. This man standing behind her. Somebody asked me, stand up there so I can see that pretty beard you got.
Why do you use Leroy Chambers for?
Well, because he's here every service is one reason. Hello? I said he's here every service. He's faithful every service. And we got to use those that are faithful. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Leroy. They was going to stop his heart over in Harriman Hospital, going to stop his heart and restart it. And they said there's a 50% chance when they stopped it, it wouldn't restart. It's beating 290-something times a minute. Something like that. Almost 300 times a minute. He's going to stop it and restart it. And they said there's a 50% chance it won't restart. They called me over there. I took my oil in there and prayed for him, and God healed him. That's been 20 years ago, and he's been in this church ever since. Hallelujah. Somebody clap your hands and say thank you. I thought that. Oh, God, in the name of Jesus, God, move on Morgan, Lord. God, move on that child. I break the powers of witchcraft. I break the powers of sorcery. Satan, loose this child. You cannot have this child in the name of Jesus. Lord, I want you to move on her and turn things around. The devil has her to be a vessel of dishonor, but God, we want her to be a vessel of honor unto you, Lord God. Do it, Lord, for your glory. I curse sorcery. I curse witchcraft. I command it to go, go, go in Jesus' name. Amen. And it shall be done. You just keep the faith and you just keep on for the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen. So this is your neighbor?
Yes.
Did she ever borrow a cup of sugar and never bring it back?
Never.
Never. Does anybody remember those days? I've done that. Amen. Amen. Poor folks had poor ways. You just do the best you could. Would y'all join hands together, please? I anoint both of you. Is it Christy? Came last Sunday. And the Lord touched her. She's got several problems, but Jesus is a problem solver. A lot of health issues. Amen. And the reason I had them to join hands, they're neighbors. They came together today. Two are better than one. Amen. And the Lord told me to pray for both of you at the same time. Father, I bless these precious ladies, Lord, that are neighbors. I ask you, Lord God, to move upon both of them. Lord, Christy, for bringing her neighbor with her today. Touch her, Lord God. Touch her in her body. And Christy, Lord, I break every issue in her body that's not like Jesus. Every sickness in her body. The progression of that sickness is leaving today. It's leaving today. Today, today, now, saith the Lord. Be healed in your body. In Jesus. Oh, my. There it is. Glory to God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory to God. Y'all just come on around here. Come on around. Come on down. Come on. Hallelujah, glory to God. Thank you, sweet Jesus. And the Lord touched you last Sunday and you wanted to run. You couldn't run.
No, I couldn't. My legs buckled.
But what was you doing today?
Oh, I did.
She wanted to come up last Sunday so bad, and Satan kept her from coming.
Who is this to you?
This is my niece, my only niece. And So she came up today, and she looked over at me, and she said, I can't do it, I can't do it. And I said, in the name of Jesus, you can do it. So I come up here, and I asked her, I said, you want me to stay with you? She said, yes. So I've been rebuking Satan the whole time that I've been here with her. Now,
amen. Amen. See, she made the effort. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I anoint you in the name of Jesus to be healed in your body. God, touch her brain, touch her mind. Touch the nerves that lead to this brain, Lord God. I don't know the medical terms, but God, you do. Heal her, double shot. Heal her, Lord. Heal her. Oh, God, in Jesus' name. There it is. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, receive it in Jesus' name. Receive your complete healing. Receive your complete healing in the name of Jesus. I drive out every infirmity, every infection in this body. Be healed in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Touch the Lord. Whoa, yes, God, in Jesus' name. It's done, it's done, it's done. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. And I pray for Mark's mother. I pray for his mother, God, that you would touch her. We send the word to her, Lord. We send healing to her. Her name is Pearl. God, I send the word to Pearl. Oh, God, in the name of Jesus. Give her a miracle, Lord. A right now miracle. Send the word to her house in Jesus' name and raise her up to be a testimony of your healing power. In Jesus' name, we call it done. Amen. Somebody clap your hands and say thank you. Glory to God. Hallelujah. It's as though, like, even in your sleep, you're wrestling, warring in your sleep. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Lord, touch her mind. In Jesus' name, I decree, Satan, you cannot torment her in her sleep and in her mind. God, the dreams that she had, let them be godly dreams. Let her dream about heaven. Oh, let her dream about praising you and her entire family praising you, Lord God. Meeting loved ones in heaven. Oh, let the mind of Christ be in her, Lord. Jesus' name, do it, do it, do it. God says, put everything in his hands. Yes, just put everything in his hand. And I will work it out for the good, saith God. For your good, just leave it in the hands of the Lord. No more tormenting at night. In Jesus' name. Deacon Daly called me last night about 8 o'clock. He said, I want you to pray for Teresa. That's his daughter. Said she's had a migraine for several days with no relief. And I said, as soon as I hang up the phone, Peggy and I are going to agree. I hanged up the phone with him, hung up the phone, or hanged it anyway. I got the phone in the cradle. Hang it, hung it. Amen. And I join hands with my wife of 56 plus years, and we come into agreement. We curse those migraine and headaches and the calls. Deacon came to me this morning. First thing I came in, he said, at about just a few minutes after you prayed last night, said those migraines are gone, been there for days. God healed her of migraine headaches. Amen. And I said that to say this, God's going to touch your mind. Amen. That you're going to have the mind of Christ even in your sleep. Glory to God. Saith the Lord. Amen. Receive it. Amen. Glory to God. Somebody say thank you.
Becky, my sister, wants me to stand in for her because she's having problems with her kidneys. Angela wants me to stand in with her, but she didn't say why. She said it was urgent. And I need a healing touch.
Amen. Did God heal you of cancer?
Yeah.
All right. And the same God that healed you of cancer is going to move in your body today. And these two requests, Becky and Angela, God's going to move on them. The Lord says we have not because we ask not. We're not beggars, we're believers. Lord, in the name of Jesus, I pray for Ella Sue as she stands in for Becky. We ask God that you'd give Becky a miracle. We ask God that you move on Angela. God, get Angela back in church. God, get her back in church. We claim her for church, for the Victory Temple Church. She used to be here, but do it again, Lord. My wife commented how that she was a little girl. Peggy used to teach her in Sunday class years ago. Now that word that's been planted in her heart, get her back in church, Lord. I decree it in Jesus' name. Amen. It's done. Somebody shout, it's done. How many know God touched you today? I said, how many know God touched you today in this house? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Now, Sister Gail, I believe it was in Morristown, you'll be coming back now, won't you? You got a good blessing. Amen. All the way from Morristown, Tennessee. Amen. I think April's got relatives up in that area, don't you? Amen. Thank God. Hallelujah. Well, I just feel good in my sanctified soul. Does anybody feel good? Now, if you don't remember nothing else, remember that the devil tries to steal your faith, because if he can steal your faith, he does what? Steals your future. Amen. And if faith doesn't make things easy, faith makes things possible. Keep that in your spirit. Keep that in your spirit. I try to pray and ask God to give me something to deposit in your spirit every Sunday when you come to this house. I want to give you something fresh from the throne room of God. Hallelujah. You know, tonight they'll be having the Super Bowl. And it's the Patriots against the Falcons. Go Falcons. I heard that. Go Jesus. I prophesy that the first time the Patriots get the ball, they'll go for a touchdown. I didn't say they'd make it, they'll go for it. I know Terry saw my post on Facebook. What, the Super Bowl coach, the winner, they pour Gatorade on his head when he wins, the winning coach, and put on Facebook, when the preacher makes a good point, you ought to pour Gatorade on his head. But don't take, no, don't.